Okay, thank you first for inviting me, and in particular, thank you to Henrik Boström, who contacted me. It's a great pleasure to be here and to talk a little bit about what we're doing in AstraZeneca. And I think we've heard some really interesting talks with, I think, a lot of overlap to what we're doing. So I don't think, even if the applications are different, I think what we fundamentally do is very similar in different areas, both in sort of industry and businesses and science. So I work in the early parts of drug discovery in a function called Discovery Sciences, and we basically support the different therapy areas and the early discovery work. So finding new molecules or different sort of types of therapies, and then take it all the way to clinic, basically where it goes into clinic, and then the development part takes over. I'll cover that a little bit more, what the process looks like and what we're doing roughly in the different stages. So I also work in a department within Discovery Sciences called Quantitative Biology. And basically it's a department of mathematicians, statisticians, bioinformaticians, and data scientists and mathematicians basically. And we are a global department, so we support the different activities on the different sites that we have, research sites, and we have sites in Mölndal, outside Gothenburg, where we do cardiovascular and metabolic disease research, but we also do respiratory and sort of lung research. And then we have oncology in Cambridge in the UK and in Boston, basically, and that's sort of cancer treatment. And you've seen a little bit around detection of cancer already before me here. So, okay, so let's get started. Well, one thing first. I think what I hope that you will get from this is some insights to how we do drug discovery, at least early on, and also how we apply some machine learning methods and why we think it's important. And also to see, generate interest in general for what we're doing. So like I said, I don't think it's very different from what you've seen before. And I think there's a lot of talent in Sweden. And of course, we would like to work with you. So no matter where you are, if it's with us or in academia or in other companies. So that's what I hope to gain here or achieve with this presentation. So just a little bit about the background. So I will tell you a little bit about the specific problems that we're facing. But the background for the pharma industry in general is that there's a lot of cost to develop drugs. And if we look at the 35 plus largest companies in the world, that's the total amount of money spent. So it's almost $60 billion in R&D. And if we compare that to other sort of sectors or other industries, the pharma industry is at top when it comes to percentage of sales spent for R&D. So it's a quite high number and it's very research intensive. And then if we look at the cost for getting a drug approved and out on the market, it's over $2 billion. So it's quite a lot of money also to go all the way. And actually, according to figures from the same organization here, Pharma, 2 out of 10 actually generate revenue. So it's quite challenging. Then if we take a closer look to the actual sort of discovery and development layout. So the beige part here, or brownish part, is the discovery part, and the blue part here is the development part. And the divider is basically where we nominate a single molecule or biologics or whatever for a clinical trial. And we go into phase one trials where we actually test this treatment in healthy volunteers. So I'll be covering this part now, or parts of that, what we're doing. And if we look at the details here, so this first part here is target to hit. So a target is basically something that we can intervene with or tamper with in cells. So some way to sort of perturb a system, which in general is the cells and things that happen in the cells. And it could be through using a small molecule, which is administered for a patient taking a pill, basically. And then we basically find a single molecule or a couple of molecules that could look very different. And then we start to develop those molecules. We look at other properties and just that we actually can treat what we think is the target that is linked to the disease. So if we take a pill, for instance, the actual substance or the drug that we're taking needs to be transported to the right part in the body, to the right tissue, and to the right cells. So that's really important. So we look at other aspects like solubility or other transportation properties of molecules in the body. And we also start to look at other aspects. For instance, there has been drugs withdrawn from the market, antihistamines, for instance, that cause death because not only did they treat the allergy reactions, but they actually blocked ion channels in the heart. So people died from taking allergy medicines. And that's definitely something that we don't want. So we're doing a lot of safety testing early on. And this sort of continues into the lead optimization part, where we also start to do sort of more regulatory work. So we need to test our potential drugs in animals and to make sure that they're safe in those systems before we go into man. The numbers down here is this first row here is sort of a probability for a project at the different phases to be successful to go to the next phase. And this is sort of a relatively rigid project structure. Many companies operate like this, at least the larger pharma companies. Other smaller biotechs might work in a different way. But so if we see here, this is sort of the probability of success to actually take one drug project from this phase to the next phase. And so the numbers here are per sort of block here all the way up here. And in phase two here, where we actually start to look at whether a drug has the desired effect, if it actually can treat a disease, we see that the success rate is relatively low. So that's a problem for us. We have drugs that, potential drugs that work very well early on, but then they translate poorly into when we treat humans, basically. And the thing is that the different things that we test here, like solubility or engagement at the target that we're interested in, we have relatively simple and cheap models early on that don't necessarily actually replicate or model what we would like to see in the clinic. So this whole thing is also a learning problem. To go from here to the end, we actually learn quite a lot of things. So we can describe it as a learning problem, but we could also describe it as an optimization problem. It's at each stage, or more or less at any given point in time, we have to make different considerations on should we, for instance, test compound A in assay one, or should we test it in assay two to actually learn more about the biological systems. And we can sort of isolate different parts here also and see and what view that as different learning systems or optimization systems. And that's where we think that machine learning can sort of be more and more helpful. I think we can skip the other numbers here. But basically, given the success rates that we've seen, and this is not AstraZeneca, this is sort of the industry in general, given those success rates and given the costs, we need to become better at what we're doing. We need to understand the biology better. We need to do it faster, maybe, and cheaper. So these three things are something that we try to tackle using machine learning-based methods, but also, I mean, other things. There are new developments when it comes to different experimental technologies that are really interesting. Okay, just something on AI and machine learning, and I guess this slide isn't really necessary for this audience, I guess, but just have it here for consistency. So, to me at least, it's a little bit difficult to say or define what intelligence actually is. I mean, there are, I think, lots of definitions of that. But the nice thing, I think, with machine learning and AI is that, and it's sort of similar to when the computers came, that we can maybe replace tedious and repetitive tasks. So we've seen already today that the machine learning based methods and computers together are really good at solving specific tasks and do it really well, much better than humans can do. But I guess going forward in the future, we may get into a situation where we need to understand how we can use humans and the machines and the algorithms that we're inventing, and to actually become much better at learning than what we are today. And it could be very simple things like, I mean, we have examples of, for phones, for instance, recommender systems of nice restaurants in the neighborhood where you are. We've seen several examples this morning, ships that showed how it can be made much easier to actually put your ad out. You can actually get an understanding of what the ask price should be of whatever you want to sell and things like that, which is of course convenient, and it saves time, and maybe it also saves you, or you would maybe earn a little bit more money. So lots of different things that can be done. And we've seen advances. I mean, we heard about the deep neural networks, and I guess the advances in GPUs and stochastic gradient descent and back propagation and things like that has enabled deep networks to become really good at certain specific tasks like object recognition and maybe speech recognition. So that's really good. And then bringing everything together, I guess, more like learning systems where these methods are just part of that is, I think, really exciting. And it's, was thinking a little bit when I thought about this presentation, I think it was 2 weeks ago or during the weekend, I have two sons, 10 and 12, and they started to generate an interest in watching movies for 15-year-olds, and we've decided sort of to go back and look at some older movies, and we watched Terminator 2, which I remembered from 1991 being, real sort of action movie, Arnold Schwarzenegger, big and bulky, and But this time around, I was actually thinking much more about the chips that they developed there and the machines and how they take over. So I guess we also need to be a little bit careful with what we're doing in the future. I guess there is a big hype at the moment, which is not avoided, and it's Gartner have their sort of annual reports of what's popular and what's expected to become useful in the future. And I think that this is from last year. I would say that I think machine learning is already really mature and really useful, and we see a demand for more and more sort of computer scientists and mathematicians, statisticians, different workplaces. But this is good because this also generates interest among senior leaders in companies, and they know that they need to think a little bit about strategies around this, which is, I guess, exciting for most people in this audience, including myself also. So, okay, so let's look at the examples of things that we're doing to become better, faster and cheaper, basically. So the first one here is an example, and I won't go much into details here, first of all, because I haven't done much of this work, but I'll try and explain a little bit what it's sort of the overview of this. And so there's sort of been developing methods around sort of designing CRISPR guides or synthetic guide RNAs together with an enzyme called Cas9 that actually enables us to edit the genes, do precise editing, which is mind-blowing, I guess, because that would allow us to not just treat symptoms of diseases, it would actually allow us to treat diseases completely. And that's, I guess, a new era for drugs, I guess, if we can have therapies like this. And there are therapies out already in clinical trials. There was on the news, I haven't been able to check the source now, so I don't know if I retell this correctly, but I think there was an Italian boy that has had a skin transplantation because he had this ichthyosis or whatever it's called. So fish skin, if you translate it from Swedish. And he was unable to go to school and live a normal life. And then they transplanted part of his skin and then edited the genes, or took out the gene or replaced the gene, and then started to grow that, and then sort of transplanted it back onto the boy. And 2 years later, which is today, he is able to go to school and live more or less a normal life. So I guess there is a lot of value in this, although it can be used also for malicious things if we're not careful. What we've done here is that we've taken basically work from a paper where they have looked at different types of RNA sequences that can be used as guides. And what happens is that this Cas9 and the guide RNA, it attaches to certain patterns, gene patterns, and then basically cuts that and sort of edits in that location. There could be off-target effects, and that's something which needs to be checked. And there could be several different guides that can be used that could have different base pairs, basically, or bases. So what we did was that we took an algorithm that was published, but we wanted to understand, just like we heard in the previous talk, how confident we are in that different guides would work. So we basically applied a framework which is called, well, the general name for it is online compression modeling, but in particular we've been using something called conformal prediction, which is quite exciting, which gives us certain guarantees, actually theoretical guarantees, on validity when it comes to predictions. So we use that basically to as a basis for our decisions, because if we have a set of guides that we potentially could use, we would like to use the ones that we're most confident in using to do the actual edits. So this is an attempt then to become better by using machine learning or AI. Another thing which is also related to deep neural networks is image analysis. So early on, we test different potential drug candidates in screens where we sort of add different types of compounds in solution to cells, basically, and then observe what happens. Images create a lot of information, and so we need to be able to handle that in a good way. Traditionally, I guess there's been a lot of feature extraction. You do edge detection and you try to find predefined objects in your images and then try to sort of classify what we call different phenotypes of different things happening to the cells when treated with different compounds. So in this particular case, we actually did a sort of an unsupervised approach. We used an autoencoder to try and sort of describe the data or the images in a different way. We used TSNE that we heard about before, just to do sort of a mapping in 2D space, and then we used those features that we retrieved from that and built another convolutional neural network classifier to classify different compounds and the effects that they had on cell types. So the thing here is for us to sort of remove manual steps to identify different features in images. And what's also interesting with image analysis in general is that we're also part of a research project that was funded by the Strategic Foundation for Research in Sweden. So Uppsala University received quite a lot of money to help us to work on this and work on some other problems that other companies have, and that project is called HASTE. And I think we have at least one person here in the audience. Yeah, Ola Spjut is sitting in the back there from Uppsala University. So that's really exciting, and we hope to be able to do a lot of things there to actually become faster in that area and in other areas. An example of how we want to become cheaper, or how we want to do things cheaper, is around property prediction for a molecule. So I mentioned that it's not just interesting to understand that we would have an effect on the target, but it's also important that we don't see other effects like tox effects, or that we understand that the compound actually can be transported to the right place in the body. So there we've used similar, I guess, to how you describe documents and words. So we've used sort of subgraphs, more or less, denoted by strings, basically. And then you could sort of see this as a, as an alphabet for molecules, basically. And then you combine those letters in this alphabet, and then that basically produces molecules which would correspond to words, basically. So in this case, we go through all the atoms, we look at neighboring atoms, and then we construct these. It's not that important now. But in this case, we actually built what we call a Mondrian transductive conformal predictor based on an underlying SVM algorithm. And the idea here is also to be able to predict with confidence, or to use the output that you get from a conformal predictor, which actually then sort of specifies uncertainty in a way for decision making. And basically the setup for us is that up until a given point in time, we have generated a lot of data in maybe one particular experiment, and then we want to build a model. And then for the subsequent compounds, or the into the future, basically a week into the future or something, or that would be generated, we would like to predict whether we should test those molecules at all, or if we even should synthesize them, because there are costs associated with synthesizing molecules. And then basically we'd like to use a model like that and then let it advance in time, update it, and then at the same time sort of keep track of whether the uncertainty or confidence estimates that we're getting, if they actually are valid, in the sense that to be more specific, if we say that we require 80% confidence in a prediction, then for all those predictions where we have this requirement, we don't allow more than 20% errors in the prediction. And the output from a conformal predictor is actually a p-value for classes. And then in this case, we've been looking at a good property and a bad property, basically, of a molecule. And we will get one p-value for each property. The larger the p-value is, the more confident we will be in the prediction. But this p-value also, at the same time, describes how similar the object, so the features of the molecule, and the label is. So if we assume that it is a good compound, combining that to the features that we have, then this combination, how similar is this in distribution to what we've seen before? And that's what we're using the p-value for. And similarly for the bad p-values. So this allows us actually to take decisions based on the predictions here. The coloring here is actually whether it belongs to one class or the other. And it's not always sort of clear cut, but what we do is that for any prediction where we would have a low p-value for the good class and a relatively high p-value for the bad class, then we would be confident that this molecule would actually have, or this compound would have, a bad property. And then it may not be useful for us to synthesize it at all, which means that we would actually save money by not doing that. If we're confident that it's really good, then of course we would like to synthesize the compound, because we may want to test it somewhere else, but it may not be necessary to test it in this particular assay, and that would also save money. And then it's also interesting here in the middle, like we heard in the previous talk, a low or a high uncertainty would correspond to inactive learning, for instance, that we would like to learn from these objects, and that's exactly what we would like to do here. So anything along the diagonal and with low p-values is actually something that we haven't seen before, which we would like to learn from. So we would probably test more in that area than anywhere else. How are we on time? Do I have like 5 minutes or so? Okay, thank you. the other interesting thing, and this is something that we're working on at the moment, is to bring this all together, become both cheaper, faster, and better at the same time. And after the summer holidays, we had a hackathon, an internal hackathon, to basically build a lab. So we pulled together some robotics equipment, assay equipment, and then basically try to build one of the blocks, the HIT identification block. I don't know if you recall that from the beige boxes that we saw. So we put that together, a team of different scientists, with the idea to be able to run basically cycles of generating new molecules, so designing new molecules, and then make them automatically in the system, test them in a bioassay, and then analyze the results and suggest the next molecule or next set of molecules to make. And then the idea is to have this running in cycles automatically to replace, or partially at least replace, what we're doing today, where one cycle like this could take 5 to 6 weeks or something like that, and to do this maybe in days. And the idea then would be to control this using active learning, reinforcement learning, or whatever. So, and then see this as an optimization problem, basically, and then try different algorithms. And we've done some of that already. So Marcus Olivecrona worked in our labs in Mundal, and he took a deep neural network and added reinforcement learning to that, and looked at the simplified case, where basically we automatically generated new molecules, and then we had a sort of a score that we wanted to increase. And then this used historical data and then assembled new molecules to improve or increase the quality or the property that we wanted. So that's quite exciting. And then, yeah, we've heard about other things. I guess I've only been talking about what we're doing in the discovery phases, but I think all across the board in the pharma industry and in other industries, there are lots of opportunities to apply machine learning and in our everyday life. I mean, in the office space, for instance, we're doing, I think, quite a few really 20th century things, and I think that we will see a lot of change just in our working environment because of these methods. But I'll stop here. Some acknowledgements on the left-hand side, different parts of AstraZeneca, QB, quantitative biology, and my manager Klaus Benson, have in a sister department, Ola Inquist, and then some other AstraZeneca teams. And then on the right-hand side, we have some collaborations. We have a project funded by the Knowledge and Competence Foundation, I guess is the translation for it, KK-stiftelsen. Henrik Boström is part of that, and with people from Borås and Jönköping. I mentioned HASTE with Carolina Welby, is the PI at Uppsala University, Andreas Helander, and Ola Spjut in the audience are part of that. We're also part in a Horizon 2020 collaboration called Escape, which is really exciting, where we try to sort of see if we can reach exascale speeds with machine learning methods and applying it to cheminformatics or chemogenomics problems. We also have collaborations with Professor Alex Gammerman, Professor Vladimir Vovk, and Professor Vladimir Vapnik. They are part of Royal Holloway. So they're actually helping us working on these cycles. So we have one person hired with them. And that's also really exciting to be working with people like that. And they are the ones who sort of developed the theories around, at least Vovk and Gammerman and Schaefer, around conformal prediction, which stemmed from ideas that Vapnik and Chervonenkis had. So by that, I stop, and I'm happy to take questions.